But the reason they're being so careful, I think, is that they're going to be asking the county for money, or they're going to be going to different places asking for money. So they have to really build a platform of being concise and focused, and they have to get their data in order to get the money. So their mission statement, the Bitterroot Task Force on Homelessness and Housing exists to alleviate homelessness and prevent housing insecurity by supporting and facilitating affordable and safe housing solutions from emergency to permanent for Ravalli County citizens of all ages, abilities, and circumstances. There's a lot in there because I don't think anybody's left out. No matter what your age, your condition, your circumstance, your financial background, you are being included in this this effort. So they developed some goals, some strategic goals. Tim said he went to a training. He's very Marine oriented, so went to a training about how to make this happen. And they said you have to quantify and collect data and do a needs assessment, and you have to build consensus. And all this is to the other end come out and get money to help people have a better life. So these strategic goals, first, and that's kind of what we're doing here,
right?
Educate about homelessness and housing insecurity in this county. You know, people will think, oh, we don't really have that problem.
Yeah,
well, we
do.
May not have that problem, but it does exist. Educate, was it educating the task force, educating the public? So those are the first two goals. Develop the task force into an inclusive cross-sector collaboration similar to a continuum of care committee, meaning bringing all these people in the county with different knowledge, abilities, interests, and to actually build this task force that can move forward. Identify the needs and then address the needs. Well, there you go. Four, identify what's currently being done in our county, a needs assessment. And then lastly, approach cities and towns in our county for requests for funding to help alleviate the problems that we identify. So it was very interesting. We had people, very, very smart, clever people. They started talking, you could tell they just had this experience. It's really an exciting buzz energy because there are people even from Missoula County who have been very successful in getting money and different slices of need, and they were there to kind of help coach and help us in our county. There was this wonderful, Hazel knew her, and I know some of you probably know her. Her name is Clarice. I'm sorry I don't have her last name here right available. I'm sure I'll find it. But she's the CFO for our county. She used to go to this church, Clarice, and she with you Hazel, and it was all this big home reunion. But Clarice, she's so folksy, but she's so smart. And she was so helpful. She was the right person. So my experience was, I met Tim, the coordinator. Obviously, I feel God has placed him at the right place at the right time to help the people in this county to orchestrate this. Clarice came, and she had a wealth of information. For decades, she's been the chief financial officer for our county. She knows the commissioners. She was very open and forthcoming about, here's how you package your request to get money to help. We cannot help nonprofits, but if you can have a product, service, something that you can deliver, then you put it in the framework of a memorandum of understanding. And she coached us, the group, how to explain to the commissioners what's needed, what we need, why we need it, and help us get money to help people. She was excellent, excellent. So that was fascinating, understanding the county budget process. So the next meeting is in April, Monday, April 17th. It'll be 9 to 12 again. I'll remind people about this meeting, but it's very interesting and encouraging.
I'll be going to that one.
Becky will be there.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
I'm developing a problem, and it wasn't spoken of today, and it doesn't take any money. But when I read about it, and I'm not sure whether it was the newspaper or one of my service magazines, as we get older, our brain does not function as fast as it used to, and people speaking fast are lost. It turns to noise.
Mm-hmm.
That we have to speak slower in order to be understood. And Fran is developing that problem too. So that a lot of meetings we go to, a half of them are just noise.
So we have to all be more mindful of that.
And the television, when I listen to the television, I listen to quite a bit of news. And I noted that the people that speak slow, I can understand what they're saying. But too many of the television news people, and I hesitate to say this, but most of them are women, speak so fast that it just turns to noise.
So I'm talking too fast?
No, I understood what you said.
Okay, but it's a very good point. And if I am, I can try to slow down. But I think it's a good point because audible, we that's why I was racing around trying to make that work, the microphone, because if you're going to utter words, why not try to make them have some use and some meaning and some value? And if we're all about trying to communicate, which hopefully we are, to try to make things better, then the number one thing is how do we really speak so we can hear and understand one another? So it's an excellent point. And I'll bring that up to Tim.
A conversational level voice, when talking to somebody with hearing aids, gets lost. It's, if you can raise your voice just a little bit.
Right.
We heard most of what Becky said today.
Oh, I'm glad. I was concerned.
There's no problem hearing you.
Okay.
Especially don't drop your sentence off.
We get lazy at the end, don't we? Yeah, thank you. And that, you know, I've always felt that way. I've always been mad about going wherever he's preached. If the microphone's not on right, it just kind of makes me a little crazy because I feel like, you know, if you're going to stand up and speak, then people need to be able to hear it because how frustrating would that be? And that's really important for all of us. So, yes.
Well, we'll be glad when the pastor gets his wraparound mic back so that
it'll be easier to hear.
Well,
exactly. Good point.
And Belinda, I'm not gonna cut you off on this, but I'm gonna address something.
Please do. Please.
I'm sorry.
I'm just one last thing I wanted to say.
Sure.
And I'm done. But it echoes what you said, Becky. Their vision for all that they're doing, and it's a goal, and it's you work toward the goal, is that citizens that. The goal is that no one would experience homelessness. Now we know people do, but that's a goal. They wanted to try to develop a safety net for people in emergency situation. Sounds good. That people could access housing with current income. Basically, that there's affordable housing available. This is the key, I think. People can age in place. With caregivers nearby, the necessary adaptations and services are near or available. So people can stay in their homes. Not only is it a nice to, but it's just cheaper. It's just cheaper.
It's way cheaper.
It's way cheaper. Housing exists for seniors and all people who don't drive, because not everybody drives. Housing options available for people coming out of prison. Supports are accessible for people if they lose their current home, rental housing, whatever. There's a process to help people. And lastly, multi-income or unrelated households can co-purchase or co-rent, and they're aware of the options of how to do that. So they have some really admirable goals. There's a lot of people who are focused, who are wanting to do really good work, and I feel really good about the person who's in charge. The can-do marine attitude, he's the right person at the right time, and they're being smart about their process. It takes a long time for the process, but they're trying to do it correctly.
Thank you for giving that report. That is one of the committees that I'm on, and I send my staff,
one
and a half person, that half person was there.
Oh, she's a half person.
She's a half person, half time. And what I was going to say about homelessness, but I'm going to address something that you all said first. At all of our meetings, what I do is, because we have both people with hearing disabilities as well as visual disabilities, we announce our names as we go around the room, and we speak one at a time. So if, let's say, I'm going to pick on Lisa. If Lisa were speaking, she would say, "My name is Lisa," and then she would go on and say, whatever. Even if you know the person who has a visual disability, when you are in a different space, like this one, or anywhere that it echoes, or anywhere there's background noise, people with visual disabilities are like, what's going on? Mm-hmm. Same with people with hearing disabilities. You try to be very clear, and like you said, Fred, speak slower so that people can understand what you're saying. And we try to do that at all of our meetings. That is a basic concept of accessibility. Mm-hmm. And I got me on my soapbox, so I'm gonna just be on my accessible soapbox for just a minute. My accessible soapbox is this. I start out every meeting and every presentation that I do that's not to necessarily a group of people with disabilities, and we talk about person first language. So, my name is Becky. I'm not handicapped. I'm not the disabled. I'm not bound to this wheelchair. Nothing is wrong with me. So, if someone comes up to me in public and says, "What's wrong with you?" I say, "Nothing." "How long have you been in that chair?" I say, "Today it was probably 5:30 this morning, 5:30. So it's learning to use the correct language. And it's not just PC, and as they say, "Oh, we have to do that." It's actually a sign of respect. Mm-hmm. It's actually treating a person with respect. And so that's my little accessible soapbox that Fred brought up and helped me bring up, and I'm going to then I'll go back to what I was talking about before. I want to talk a little bit about homelessness for people with disabilities.
Okay. One point. People may not have hearing loss, but their brain, what the article was saying was that the brain operates slower. And therefore, you don't understand, even if you don't have a hearing loss, you don't understand what's being said. They don't comprehend what people are saying when they speak too fast.
Mm-hmm. And I found that with people that I work with that have had injuries or other sensory disabilities.
It's also for people who live in Western Texas. Because he was for 2.5 years at two churches, and I'll never forget this man. He talked like this, and I realized we were new, and I was getting excited, and I was talking faster, and he was just looking at me like this. And then he just said, "Belinda, you really talk fast."
So safety, and this is a project that I said Rosemary Hughes is going to come and talk to my women's group, that she ran a research project out of the University of Montana Rural Institute on Disabilities. And they are more likely to be in domestic violence situations. They are about 5 to 10 times more likely to be homeless. They are more likely to be last hired, first fired. If you think the employment rate is bad among people in general, for people with disabilities, it's still running about 75% of either being unemployed or underemployed. Mickey can tell you from his experience when he does his talks to kids, he was underemployed simply because of access issues. He could have moved up, but because of the buildings that, you know, that they worked in, there was a lack of access. So everything that you think about that could possibly be difficult for everyone else, add a disability to that and multiply it. That's what life with a disability is like. We are the largest minority in the United States. And whether you count yourself as one of us or not, and that's what we do in independent living, we go, yeah, I'm a person with a disability, you know, and all of that. But whether you count yourself or not, as you age, guess what? Disability is a natural part of the human process. Either that or you're dead. And we just addressed this issue with our kids the other week. Everyone in the world does not have a disability. Tell me why that is. I'm just making that statement.
Babies.
No. Everyone in the world, and this was a statement that was made, everyone in the world has disabilities. Because everybody was looking at me funny. So I meant to say has disabilities.
Oh, sure. Limitations.
Why would that? I argued that it was not true. Why would I argue that?
Depends on how you define it.
Depends on how you define it. Okay, let me ask you this. How many people, raise your hands right now, have a house with stairs?
A house with stairs.
Everybody in this room, just raise your hand. Now, if you have one step, that's the Grand Canyon for me. I cannot get into your house. How many people have 36-inch wide doorways in their home? No idea.
That's wider than.
I think standard is 30, isn't it?
And bathroom doors can be a lot narrower than that.
So hallways, doors.
So we're also working on the concept of what's called visitability. Mm-hmm. And if you visit our website, which is on the back of your sheet, www.summitilc.org, on the back of your sheet, our website, we have a visitability page that talks about zero-step entryways, wider doorways. We're not asking people to have their entire house accessible. Visitability asks that people can get in one way, one door. They can visit in one room, and they can use the bathroom. It doesn't mean it has to be the most accessible bathroom on the face of the earth with huge wide doorways and grab bars. It just means they can get in there. Because the main place that people socialize in our country is within their own homes with people. And every time I do one of these, every single person, when I say steps, there is their hand. So if everyone